So just to recap, here we have the scenario where we have two components which needs to be fitted together. One of the component which we are calling as a shaft has a specific dimension which is basically represented by the basic nominal size or basic nominal dimensions, which is this line dash dotted line. And the shaft, as you can see, is not manufactured and fabricated at its basic dimension. There may be several reasons for that, either it is because of the manufacturing error, because the turning operation was such that it was not able to get that exact basic size. So there may be some tolerances that are there, deviations from the basic size that will result in a part which is different from the basic dimension. And that difference, you basically are seeing there are two lines here. Can you guys see the cursor that I'm moving in the screen?
Yeah, we can.
Okay, great. So this is the line which represent the basic dimension, the line or the projection of the shaft component which is closest to the basic dimension is called as the fundamental deviation, the fundamental deviation from the basic size. And then on top of that, you add a tolerance zone based on how much tolerance you are specifying, which is specified by the IT number, the International Tolerance Grade number. So that is for the shaft. And similarly for the hole, you will see that there is a dime dash of the line which represents the basic size. From there onwards, whatever the deviation occurs for the part is called the fundamental deviation. And on top of that fundamental deviation, if you add the tolerance based on the designer specification in the drawing, that is basically going to give you the variation of the size of the hole. So the size of the hole in this case is basically ranging from this size, which is minimum size, to the maximum size. So that is basically we saw while we were discussing about limits and fits, and based on the specifications about the fundamental deviation and the tolerances, we can calculate what should be the minimum diameter and the maximum diameter. So as I was showing you, this chart on the right basically showing you the specific values corresponding to the basic size, which results in the tolerance zone. So these are basically the chart representing the tolerance, the extra amount of tolerances that you are specifying, the tolerance for this here, the shaft, and similar tolerance amount for this hole. So if you see tolerance grade of 6 for the diameter of 30 millimeters, then basically you mean you are adding a tolerance of 0.01. So that is what basically this chart shows. And the next chart basically represents the fundamental deviation. What is the amount of fundamental deviation? So if you see here in this chart, there are values which are negative and positive. And the negative values are corresponding to letter grade C, D, F, G. For H, in this column, everything is zero. That means fundamental deviation is zero for letter grade H. And for letters C, D, F, and G, the fundamental deviation is negative. What it means by negative means that the shaft dimension is basically less than the basic size. That is what this negative values basically mean. So what it means that the fundamental deviation is on the right-hand side. It means the shaft diameter is less than the basic size, which basically means that the type of fit will be a special type of fit. So if I ask you guys, can you guess what type of fit would it be? Would it be clearance fit or would it be interference fit? If I have a fundamental deviation denoted by these letters C, D, F, and G. Is my question clear to you guys, or do I need to explain it more?
Yeah, could you go over it again?
Yeah, let me go over it again. So what I'm showing here is that this is a chart that represents the amount of fundamental deviation. What is the fundamental deviation? For the shaft, not for the hole, for the shaft. So for the shaft, I have got this line represents the basic dimension, nominal size. And from here onwards, whatever the amount I am away from this basic dimension is called as fundamental deviation. So if my fundamental deviation is negative, which is given by these values, that means my shaft is less than the basic size. So that is what these numbers are showing. Now, my question is that if my shaft is less than the basic size, would it result in an interference fit or a clearance fit?
Interference fit?
Interference?
The whatever clearance? Clearance fit?
Clearance. Yeah, well,
not interference. I couldn't understand what the other one was.
Clearance.
Clearance, okay.
Yeah, clearance fit.
Yeah, it will be clearance fit, right?
Yeah.
Just give me a second, I'm just drawing the schematic in the paper, and let me share that with you guys. Let me share the document camera. So what I'm basically drawing here is a component which I'm presenting as a whole, and this is the basic, this line represents the basic size or nominal size. And this much amount, as you can see here, this is represented by fundamental deviation. This is called as fundamental deviation. So if this fundamental deviation is negative, that means I have my shaft dimension, which is less than the basic size. So let's say basic size is 34 millimeters. That is my basic size. And my fundamental deviation, so let's say the specification is something like this, 34H7C6. Let's say that is the specification in the drawing that you can see for the type of it. So in that case, I know that this is my basic size. This letter grade represents the type of fundamental deviation for the whole. The first one is for the whole type of fundamental deviation for whole. And this letter represents type of fundamental deviation for the shaft. Fundamental deviation for the shaft. The numbers 7 and 6 basically represent the international tolerance, the amount of tolerance that I'm going to specify for the hole and for the shaft. So this is the IT7 tolerance grade 7 tolerance, extra tolerance on top of the fundamental deviation, tolerance for hole. And this number is basically representing IT6, international tolerance grade 6 for the shaft. So quickly, if I have to ask you what will be the dimensions, minimum and the maximum diameter of the shaft and the hole, you can easily calculate that by looking at the fundamental deviation for letter grade C. So for letter grade C, 34 millimeters is the basic dimension, and C letter grade is representing a negative value, which, can you guys quickly let me know what that value is? Which is
negative 0.12.
Just give me a second. Negative 0.12. Yeah, negative 0.12. So basically, you have negative point.
Professor?
Yes.
I can no longer see your screen or your visualizer.
Yeah, me neither.
Just give me a second. Can you see it now?
No, I can.
Yes.
You can, right? Yeah?
Yes. Yeah.
Great. So for letter grade C, the fundamental deviation is 34 minus 0.120, it will be 33.880 millimeter will be the diameter of this shaft. On top of that, if I have to add a tolerance of IT6, can you guys tell me what that number would be? For IT6 corresponding 34 millimeters, what should be the value I'm getting?
0.016.
So what I'm doing here is that since my fundamental deviation is negative, basically it is less. So whatever tolerance, extra tolerance, I am further reducing from here. So my shaft will be can be further be reduced by that amount, which is my tolerance grade. This is representing my IP6. And that basically will result in 34.864 millimeters. Yeah. So basically what I'm getting with these specifications that my shaft dimensions will be varying from 33.864 millimeter, that is my minimum diameter, and 33.80880 to be the maximum diameter. Let me know if you guys are able to get that much part here.
Yeah.
Everybody is good so far?
Yeah.
Good. And similarly for the hole, if we have H7, for the hole, the fundamental deviation for H, let us get H is zero. So 34 millimeters is basically the minimum diameter of the hole, and the maximum diameter of the hole would be basically given by the tolerance amount, which is given by IT7 here. So can you guys tell me what would be the IT7 number corresponding to 34 millimeters? How much tolerance IT7 column says for 34 millimeter diameter?
0.025.
So basically I am here adding this tolerance. So just you have to make sure that you understand this problem. Sometimes I'm taking this number, which is corresponding to IT7, and I am just adding on this basic dimension. The reason I'm adding into it, because for the hole, it is basically going to add on to that. So it basically the hole will be enlarged further. So either the hole will have 34 millimeter as the minimum size, or it will be much further enlarged by 34.025. So the minimum size for the hole is, minimum diameter for the hole is this much for the hole, and the maximum diameter is this much. Now here, what I did, the tolerance grade, I subtracted. Why I subtracted it? Because my fundamental deviation is already negative. It is already less than the basic size. So on top of that, I need to add further the tolerance on the negative side. That is why I added on the negative side. So you have to just remember these specific differences and why I'm adding this and why I'm subtracting this. The reason I'm doing this, because no matter whether whatever the numbers of the tolerance shows, they are basically on top of the fundamental deviation. So fundamental deviation is this much, and on top of that, I'm going on the negative side for the IT6, which is here, negative. For the hole, it is basically the fundamental deviation is almost zero, because it is for the degrade H corresponding to basic size. On top of that, I'm going to add a tolerance zone on the positive side. So that is why I added it. If it makes sense to you, please let me know. If it doesn't make sense to you, please let me know. I'll try to explain it again. And if it doesn't make sense to you, or if it makes sense to you in both cases, try the same approach for this specification. 34H7 pieces. Now I've changed the letter grade from C to P. The only thing that is changing is from this specification to this specification, the only thing that is changing is the letter grade is now changed from C to P. So with that, if you see in the table, the P corresponds to a difference fundamental deviation. Everything else will remain same. So I will go through the calculations and these steps again. Hopefully it will make some sense to you. So let's say, for the hole, what will be the minimum and maximum diameters? And for the shaft, what will be the minimum and maximum diameters? 34H7, basic size 34 millimeters, both cases, everything is same. H, hole basis, everything same. 7IT7, which is here. So all these values remain the same. Basically, it means the minimum diameter of the hole is 34 millimeters, and the maximum diameter of the hole is 34 plus 0.025, the same thing that I was doing here, adding the value from IT7 table. And that is what is called. That is, I'm getting 34.025. Is everybody with me so far on this?
Yes.
Yes.
Any questions from anybody? If not, let's do this for the shaft. Now for the shaft, how can I get the minimum diameter? It will be 34 millimeters. Now for letter grade P, what is the fundamental deviation? Can somebody look at it and let me know? We just need to look at the slide and the chart, and you have to see the corresponding value for column P, the column representing letter P.
Positive 0.026.
Positive 0.026. Now here you see now it becomes 34.026 as the minimum diameter. This is the fundamental deviation. Fundamental deviation corresponding to letter P. It is positive number. That basically means that my shaft is now beyond this basic size. So my shaft, new shaft, is going to be not here, but this, it will be on the left-hand side of my basic size. And the maximum diameter will be how much? It will be the tolerance amount, which is corresponding to IT6. This is at IT6. This tolerance amount will now be added to this. So let's me do that. So 34 plus 0.026, that is the fundamental deviation, plus IT6, 0.016. So the same value is now added in here, and what I'm getting is 34.042 millimeters. So that is the maximum diameter of the shaft, 34.042 and 34.026. This is coming from IT6. So everything remains the same, except that because my letter grade has changed from C to P, my fundamental deviation has changed from negative to positive. So that means now my shaft will not be lying here, but my shaft will be bigger from bigger than the basic size. And if my shaft is bigger than the basic size, then the tolerance amount that I'm going to get will be further added on top of that. So it will be add, not subtract. So eventually I get the values like this. Is that make sense to you?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. And if there are any questions from anybody, please let me know.
Professor, these tables that you're using, they're on Beatport?
They are in your textbook. And I also put the snapshot of that in the slides, in lecture number 3 slides, the last lecture slides.
Okay, sounds good.
So what we are actually looking at is basically a component. So we have one component, and there is another component, which is a mating component. It can be pulley, it can be gear, it can be hub of any component that is going to be inserted into the shaft. So what we are basically seeing is we are getting a type of fit, which is called an interference fit. And that is the amount of interference we are actually observing. Because if you see here, the minimum diameter is 34.026 millimeters, and the maximum diameter of the hole is 34.025 millimeters. So no matter whatever the hole specification is, and no matter what will be the shaft specification is, there's always going to be some amount of interference. And this specification corresponds, or it's called as interference fit. And this specification corresponds to clearance fit. So I think we actually covered this much in the last lecture as well. So I just wanted to make sure we actually recap that so that we actually are all on the same page. Now going further, what are the complications, what are the implications of this? So what this interference is going to cause? And that is the interesting part here for the designers. So because of this interference, whenever I'm going to press this shaft into this component, which is, can be gear, it can be pulley, it can be any other bearing, it can be some other component that is getting inserted into the shaft. Because of this interference, what is going to happen? The material is going, we have two things. The material is going to be stressed. Is going to be stressed. And why it is going to be stressed? Because of the clamping pressure. Because of clamping pressure, isn't it? Yeah?
Yes.
So depending on how much amount of interference is, the pressure is directly proportional, the damping pressure is directly proportional to the amount of interference. So this is the amount of interference. This is the clamping pressure. This is the amount of interference. So depending on the amount of interference, the clamping pressure will change. Now, why I'm saying that we have a proportionality sign and whether whether the amount of interference will change or not. So if we look at this example, can you tell me what will be the minimum interference and what will be the maximum interference? If you look at this, suppose you are fabricating the hole and the shaft, you are machining it, and you are getting the dimension somewhere between ranging from 34 to 34.025 for the hole, and for the shaft, you are getting somewhere from 34.026 to 34.042. What will be the minimum interference do you think you guys will get? The minimum interference, if you actually look at the ranges, it will be when the shaft is at the minimum specification and the hole is at the maximum specification. So it is 34.026 minus 34.025. Is that 0.001 millimeter, isn't it? That is the minimum amount of interference. So no matter whatever the values you get, you will always get this much amount of interference, which is the minimum interference. Yeah? And the maximum interference is going to be when the shaft is at the maximum diameter and the hole is at the minimum diameter. So if I have 34.042 as my shaft diameter and my hole has been drilled or basically machined at 34 millimeter specification, then I will have the maximum amount of interference. So this is the amount of interference that you will get. Minimum amount of interference is 0.001 and the maximum amount of interference that you are going to get is 0.042, right? Are you guys following what I'm trying to say here?
Yes.
Yeah,
if there are any questions, any confusion from anybody, please let me know. I'll try to explain. So if not, then what I was basically then referring to here is that the clamping pressure, the amount of pressure, if you are you are trying to have an interference fit, there will be some clamping pressure between the two components. And that pressure is going to cause stresses to be generated. So you will have radial stresses and tangential stresses in the material, and they will all be a function of, so I'm not going to the derivation or basically the expressions of these stresses and the pressure, but they will be a function of your pressure, which in turn is a function of your interference. So F and G are nothing but the function, mathematical function. So stress sigma radial is a function of pressure. Tangential stress will be a function of pressure. And since pressure is directly proportional to the interference, amount of interference, so it will be basically another function of interference. So eventually what is happening here that these stresses in the material are going to be dependent on how much amount of interference is happening. So if my interference is only this much, which is 0.001, I will have less stresses. If my interference is 0.042, I will have more stresses. So very trivial question, in which case do you think the as a designer, you need to be concerned about from the materials first failure point of view, which of the type of interference you will be concerned, whether it is the minimum amount of interference you will be concerned about, or whether it will be the maximum amount of interference that you will be concerned about?
Would it be maximum?
Maximum. And the reason is?
If you go too far, you'd have too much pressure buildup.
Yes.
It may damage the part.
Exactly. So if you go too further in the type of interference, you will get more amount of pressure. More amount of pressure means you are inducing more stresses in the material. If you're inducing more stresses in the material, that means it has more chances of failure. So that is what, as a designer, you need to worry about, that what is the maximum interference you should be getting for this specification of your type of fit. Now, how to get the stresses, value of stresses as a function of delta or interference, and how to combine these stresses using von Mises criteria or any other failure criteria to determine whether failure is taking place or not, that's we have already looked at or we have already seen. So I'm not going into those details. So the important part is that as a designer, I am only concerned about what is the maximum amount of interference that is going to happen and what type of stresses are going to result from them. So that is what you will actually get by looking at the maximum amount of interference. So the next question is, if delta max is what is going to be important, what is the significance of delta minimum? So let me actually describe where delta minimum would be useful. I'm just trying to make one schematic. Let me see if I can make it a rough sketch here. So let's say we have a schematic of a component. I'm calling this as, let's say a pulley that is basically mounted on a shaft, transmission shaft. And when they are basically inserted together, there is interference that is happening. Now, what happens that this shaft is connected to a motor which is supplying a torque to it. So torque is basically supplied as a torque input, which is supplied by the motor. It can be supplied by anything, any other means, but let's say a motor is supplying a torque, and that torque needs to be transmitted by the pulley as well, using the belts that are basically attached, the belts that are attached on the two side of it. So if you are wrapping a belt and you are basically having a tighter side and a loose side belt, so they are basically carrying certain tensions, which is going to carry the amount of torque that is being transmitted. Now we are focusing our attention on the interference zone, the zone where the shaft is connected to the pulley. So when the shaft is connected to the pulley, there is no other means of connecting the pulley to the shaft. It is just like pure interference. It is just like you're clamping the pulley on the shaft, and they are somehow attached together. So when the shaft starts spinning, what do you think? What is going to happen with the pulley? Is it going to spin with itself or with the shaft, or will it be like slipping on that?
It depends on the interference fit, right?
Yeah, it depends on the interference fit, of course. So let's say the shaft and the pulley are not slipping. So they are basically having an interference, which is basically means that they are basically spinning together. So the shaft is spinning and the pulley is spinning as well along with it. So both of them are rotating at the same angular velocity. So in that case, if you look or if you focus your attention on the inside of the pulley, what is happening that the pulley is basically experiencing some amount of friction because of, let's say step by step, what is going to happen? When you apply a torque to the shaft will start to spin, and when it try to spin, because of the interference, it will try to take the pulley along with itself. Now, the way that this torque is being transmitted by the pulley is because of the friction. So the friction is basically letting the pulley rotate along with the shaft, isn't it? Yeah, right? Are you guys following it?
Yes,
So if that is the case, now how to get the amount of friction? So if I actually see that this is my pulley, which I actually taken out from the shaft now. And what is going to happen with this pulley, that there will be this pressure that will be generated because of the interference. This is my pressure that is going to happen, or that is going to be generated. And this pressure, this pressure, internal pressure, because of the interference, will going to create a friction force. And the amount of friction force can be generated or can be obtained by multiplying the coefficient of friction with the normal force. And a normal force to this is basically given by pressure times area. What is the area of this surface, internal surface? Can somebody tell me what will be that area would be? If the internal radius of the shaft is R, or let's say the diameter of the shaft is D. So what is the internal radius of the hole will be? I mean, we're talking about basic size here at this point of time. So the diameter of the hole, the basic diameter or the basic size of the diameter of the hole will be D as well, isn't it?
Ideally, yeah.
So what will be the area of the internal surface? Can I tell you what will be the area of this internal surface on which this pressure is building up?
Pi r squared times L, I think.
So it will not be pi r squared. It will be circumference times L. So circumference is going to be what? It is 2 pi r L, right? So pi r squared basically means the area of the circle itself. I don't want area of the circle. I want the circumference of the circle multiplied by the length. That will be give me the curves and the area of the curve surface, isn't it? Yeah?
Yeah.
So that will be what you will get. 2 pi r, r is d over 2 times L. That will be the area. So this is the friction force that is going to be generated. So it will be F times P times pi times D times L. And because of this friction force, the amount of torque due to that friction force would be this friction force multiplied by the radius again. The radius will be D over 2. So that means that will be PF times, F is a coefficient of friction. So this is your coefficient of friction. F times P times pi D L times D over 2, which basically means F pi P D square L over 2. So that will be your amount of torque that will be carried, or that can be transmitted from the shaft to the pulley because of this pressure. So how the torque is being transmitted? Torque is being transmitted from the shaft to the pulley because there is a friction inside the surface. There is a friction and there is a clamping pressure. So it is the amount of torque is a function of the friction coefficient. So it is a coefficient of friction. It is a function of the clamping pressure. So what is the amount of clamping pressure that is being generated? So that is also there, clamping pressure. It is a function of the diameter, or whatever the size of the hole is, the bigger diameter will be, the more we torque transmitting capacity would be. And it will be the function of length, how much length of the surface area is. So if we have more length or wider area, you have more wide surface, you will have more torque transmitting capacity. So these are basically this is basically a generic expression for calculating how much the torque can be transmitted from the shaft to the pulley without the slippage happens. So in case the amount of torque that the motor is supplying is greater than this value. So in case one, T input from the motor side is greater than what the frictional coefficient and frictional surfaces are able to provide, then what you're going to have is what? What is going to happen in that case?
The pulley would slip from the shaft?
Yes, exactly. So the slippage will occur. And which will spin faster? Slippage will occur. Which will spin faster?
The shaft?
The shaft, right? Because the motor is providing a torque to the shaft. It is trying to rotate the shaft at a higher torque. And that torque is not being transmitted to the pulley because the pulley can only supply or only sustain this much amount of torque based on the friction coefficient. So that means slippage will occur and the shaft will be spinning faster, right? Case number two would be that T input is less than Tf, the amount of torque that can be transmitted through the friction coefficient. What is going to happen in this scenario?
They won't, there's no slipping.
No slipping, perfect. So no slipping and both shaft and pulley will be rotating at the same speed. Shaft and pulley rotating at same speed. Are you guys getting what I'm trying to say here? We are doing here?
Yes.
Yeah. Yes.
Any questions or any confusion in anybody's mind or any concerns or any issues you guys have in this explanation? I will try to explain again then. Everybody is good so far?
Yeah.
Yeah. So now my question to you guys would be that if as a designer, you have to pick a value of interference, which is, you know, there can be a minimum amount of interference and there can be a maximum amount of interference. The minimum amount of interference was 0. Let me actually bring that sheet again. So in this case, we saw that during the interference fit, the minimum interference was 0.001 millimeters and the maximum interference was 0.04 millimeters. So minimum was 0.001 millimeters and the maximum interference was 0.042 millimeters. So because of these interferences, there will be two values of the clamping pressure. You will get P minimum based on this value of interference, you will get P maximum based on this value of interference. Are you guys following it, what I'm trying to say here?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. This is what the clamping pressure is, amount of clamping pressure. If you have a minimum interference, the clamping pressure will be less. If you have a maximum interference, the clamping pressure will be maximum or more. So if as a designer, you have to find the torque transmitting capacity, the rated torque trans or the rated capacity of this system, of this pulley and shaft system based on the type of interference, which value of P do you think would be critical in your estimation? Will it be this value or will it be this value? Which value will give you more torque transmitting?
Well, will give us what, Professor? More what?
More torque, more amount of torque can be transmitted. Which value of these two pressures? Okay,
would it be Pmax?
Pmax, yeah. Let me actually try to rephrase my question if it is not clear to you guys. I got this expression for finding what is the amount of torque that can be transmitted because of the friction coefficient and clamping pressure. And based on the type of interference, I have either the minimum interference or the maximum interference. Based on the minimum interference, I will have minimum pressure and a maximum pressure. Now, if I got two values of pressure, I will definitely get two values of the torque, right? This will give me Tf minimum, and this will give me Tf frictional torque maximum. Are you guys with me, everybody?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. So which of these two would be the value you will quote in your estimation? When you go and say to a customer, let's say that you have designed a system and you are rating it for a given torque rating, which of these two are you going to pick?
Your max, right?
Okay, so let me give some numbers here. Let's say for the numbers, I am 100 Newton meters. Say, these are numbers, say. And this is 90 Newton meters, or let's say 80 Newton meters. So as a designer, how will you rate your system? Is it going to transmit 100 Newton meters, or is it going to be good for 80 Newton meters?
80 Newton meters.
80, yeah, 80.
80. You see the point right here?
Yeah.
So because you will basically quote the value, which will be worst case scenario. The worst case scenario happens where? When the magnetic appearance is less.
And actually, don't usually companies give you a value even smaller than that, Professor, just in case?
Yeah. So that will be a factor of, you can throw in another factor of safety in there. So that is a different discussion altogether, that you can have a factor of safety thrown in here. But what I'm saying, that theoretical perspective, if you have to rate your system for the torque transmitting capacity, you are not going to quote this number. You are going to quote this number, because as a designer, you are saying that whatever type of interference it happens in the system, you are always going to be able to transmit at least 80 Newton meters. You can get more than that. If your interference is maximum, you can get this much. But at least based on this amount of interference, you will get 18 Newton meters. So you are going to quote this number, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. So this is the place where this minimum amount of interference becomes useful. So that will be useful in designing the torque transmitting capacity of your design based on the interference rate. Is everybody with following this much? So remember, yeah. We were doing, if I bring back the previous sheet here, I was starting with this specification 34F7P6. We got this dimensions and we found out the minimum interference will be this much, maximum interference will be this much. Now, what I was saying that if as a material scientist or if as a designer, I have to worry about how much stresses are going to build up in the material, I'm going to use this maximum interference, because this maximum interference will give me the stresses and those will be the maximum stresses, and this will give me the more chance of failure to happen. So I will be interested in getting the maximum interference. But if my problem is changed, and my problem is now to find what is the torque transmitting capacity for this system where you have an interference between pulley and the shaft, then I will basically focus my attention with minimum amount of interference, because this is the value which will govern or which will basically dictate the value or a torque transmitting capacity for this design. Does it make sense to you guys? Or if you have any questions, please let me know. Is everybody good so far?
Yeah, I'm good.
Yeah.
Any questions from anybody? So if not, then I will quickly go through lecture 3 slides, which is basically the slides from the last lecture, and wrap that up first. So this is basically the chart showing the fundamental deviation and some of the calculations for finding the shaft and the hole. We already have seen that. These are some example problems. Okay, this is the chart where I was basically showing you the expressions for the pressure, the clamping pressure. The pressure is basically a function of the interference, amount of interference, delta, where these diameters, the Young's modulus, the Poisson's ratio are basically known to you depending on what type of material you are using. So based on this pressure, you can find the tangential stresses and the radial stresses by using these expressions. You don't need to remember this expression. That's why I have not even written them down. It is basically what you have to take away message from here is that the clamping pressure is a function of the interference. So the more the interference, more will the clamping pressure. And if the pressure is more, if you look at the expression for the stresses, if the pressure is more, the stresses will be more. So basically, you can use these expressions and calculate what the stresses would be for a given amount of interference. And from there onwards, you can use failure criteria and you can check whether the material is going to fail or whether it is going to survive under the given load condition. So that is for the stress capacity. And for torque transmitting capacity, we know that we are interested in the minimum value because our frictional force and the torque, amount of torque can be transmitted depends on this pressure, and we are going to use minimum amount of interference for calculating torque capacity. So that is what we have seen as well in the document. So having said that, and if there are no other questions, then I will come to the lecture slides for going through the design calculations for the bell drive. So let me actually share that first. So any questions and concerns, guys, so far? Yeah. Everybody is following it so far?
Yeah,
we're still here.
Yeah, good. Okay, so the next component that we are going to learn in this class is belt drive selection, or how to select a specific belt drives for power transmission. So before we actually go to the calculations, just a few introductory slides. Let's go through that. Let's go through them first. First of all, flexible mechanical elements. I mean, these drives are basically constituted flexible mechanical elements. Flexible means they flex. They are basically can be wrapped around pulleys of different diameters, and then can change their orientation and configuration based on how you are actually wrapping it up around the pulleys of different sizes. So when we look at belt drive mechanisms, there are a few distinct categories of mechanism that you can see here. One is we call as V belt drives, as you can see here. And when you see the V belt drives, basically these are wrapped around pulleys which have grooves in it. So the V belt drives are wrapped around the pulleys with grooves. And you can also have flat belt drives, but here there you can see the pulleys do not have any grooves. They are basically flat head pulleys, and there are some crowning. Crowning basically means so as to make sure that the belt does not slip from one side to the another. So you can have flat belt drives. You can either have chain drives and tooth belts as well. Now, if you look between, there is a very subtle difference between the belt drives and the chain drives or tooth belts. And one of the very subtle differences is that in the belt drives, in the V belt or flat belts, you do not see any serration or teeth. But if you see in chain drives or in tooth belts, there are teeth or the serrations on the surface of the belt. And when they are actually wrapped around the pulley also have a teeth to it. So you can say the chain and sprocket, the sprockets have the tooth in it as well. And this pulley also have the teeth in it, which gets engaged with the serrations or the profile of the belt from the inside. So can you guys just have a look at these pictures and just think what can be the pros and cons of having a teeth versus no teeth on the belt drive? I mean, both of them are basically corresponding or constituting the components of flexible mechanical drives or flexible mechanical elements. But these drives, tooth belt drives, are different from the flat belt or V belt drives in some respect. Can you identify that?
Yeah, without teeth, you increase the chance of slippage. So I think tooth and chain drives are normally used where you don't want, or there's more torque, or you don't want any slippage in the belt. So you would go with that instead of the V belt or flat belt.
Yeah, that's perfect. That's correct. That in case of flat belts or V belts, there's a chance of slippage between the belt and the surface of the pulley. But if you look at this chain drive and tooth belts, there is no way that you can have slippage between the belt and the pulley because they are positively engaged from one teeth to the another. So there is no way that their slippage can take place. So what happens is that there is a constant angular velocity ratio between the driving shaft and the driven shaft. So this is the driving pulley. Usually smaller ones we basically categorize as driving pulley and the bigger one is driven pulley. So if you look at the speed, this ratio of the angular velocity of the input side to the output side will always remain constant because the belts which are basically transmitting the power and transmitting the motion, which will not allow any slippage because of the serrations, and that means the velocity ratio will remain constant. Whereas if you look at these drives, flat belt drives or V-belt drives, these belts can have some slippage between the surface of the pulley and the belt. And because of that slippage, what will happen that the velocity ratio will not be constant. The angular velocity ratio between the input side and the output side will not be constant. So in case if you want a positive engagement, a positive, you really need a constant angular velocity ratio, then you will go for this tooth belt drive or chain drives. But if you do not need that constant angular velocity ratio, you are only concerned about transmission of power from one shaft to another, from input to output, you don't need those serrations. And as you can see, another difference is the cost of manufacturing. Manufacturing this cost and is basically is higher than V-belt and flat belt drives. So that is also another concern that you basically need to address or you need to take into account while selecting a specific drive for the system. So having said that, any questions from anybody so far? Okay, if not, so some of the geometric characteristics here, how the flat belt drives and cross section looks like, and what is the center distance. Center distance is basically between the input side and the output side. So for the input shaft to output shaft, what is the center distance between the two? And for flat belt drives, there is generally no upper limit for both flat belt and round belt. For V belt and timing belt, there are generally limitations on the center distance. So some of the common belt materials, flat belts are made of urethane and rubber impregnated fabric, and they have some steel wires in it so as to increase the load carrying capacity so that they basically can carry more tension load. And the efficiency wise, they have around 98% efficiency, which is almost the same as gear drive. So in case you have the choice between selecting a gear drive versus a belt drive, then you can easily go with belt drives, and the advantage you will get here is that you will have less cost or less weight of the system because you are not going to deal with bulky gears. The belt drives can allow the center distance between the input and output to be greater than, large center distances can be possible or can be accommodated for the power transmission. So generally, belt drives provide a very cost-effective way of transmitting power from one shaft to the next. And as you can say, flat belts are quiet. They are quiet in operation. And V-belts are generally used for shorter distances. Timing belts, another factor apart from the manufacturing cost and the constant angular velocity ratio, another point to be concerned about or basically to take into account is the timing belts does not stretch or slip. So that is another positive part of the transmission timing belts. It can be positive, it can be negative as well. Negative in the sense that because it cannot stretch or slip, that means it will have more wear and tear, or it can have more fatigue. Because of fatigue, it has less life. So you basically need to be concerned about the life of the timing belts while selecting it for a specific application. Whereas in case of normal belts, you basically need some sort of a tightening, idle pulleys, idlers to increase the tension or initial tension, or providing an initial tension to the belts. You can provide some idler pulleys, or you need some mechanism to increase the tension, and you can adjust that as the wear and tear occurs. So you don't need to replace the whole belt altogether. But in timing belts, if the wear and tear starts and the fatigue life is not very high, then you have to worry about replacing the timing belt altogether. So these are some of the characteristics, are some of the points and cons for consideration while selecting the belt drive. So any questions so far, guys?
No.
Okay. So what I'm showing here is basically a geometrical arrangement between the input side and the output side. So input shaft here, you can see, and the belt is wrapped over and is going through the outer diameter of the, or the outer surface of the pulley, or the driven pulleys. Usually the smaller, as I was mentioning, the smallest diameter pulley is called as driving pulley, and the bigger diameter pulley is called a driven pulley. So this is the input side, this is the output side. And what you are actually seeing here is that it's just a angle of wrap. Angle of wrap is basically means that how much amount of the belt is starting to touch the surface of the pulley, and then it is leaving that contact. So from the point of starting the contact to the point of leaving the contact is what we call as angle of wrap of the belt around the pulley. So you have theta subscript small d for the smaller diameter and theta subscript big D for the bigger diameter. So it is basically the point at which the belt starts touching the pulley and then it will leave the pulley. So from that point to this point, whatever the angle of wrap is or whatever the whatever this this segment of the belt is subtending an angle is called as the angle of wrap. And they are basically function of the geometric distances. So if you know the rate diameters, you know the center distance, you can use trigonometric formula to get the angle of wrap. So this is basically a function of center distance and the diameter of the pulley. So this is just a mathematical expression. You can use some trigonometric relationship and you can get the angle of wrap for the driven side and the driving side. This is for open belt configuration. And this is called as closed belt. Cross belt configuration is basically means that you have the belts are crossing each other while they are passing. So that is a cross belt configuration. Again, you see the expressions for the angle of wrap. And these are all geometrical relationships. You can easily get that or basically derive it by yourself. So you don't have to, I mean, these are just mathematical expressions of finding how much is the angle of wrap for the driven side to the drive side. And the reason we are interested on knowing this value of what is the angle of wrap, or what is the, how much amount of the belt surface is wrapping around the pulley, because this is the portion of the belt material that is going to transmit the power. So the more the angle of wrap, the more would be the surface area will be in contact with the pulley. That means the more will be the frictional friction will come into play, because it is all based on friction, how the friction is helping to transmit the power from one surface to another. So if you have more surface area in contact, you will have more frictional force. That means you have a more torque transmitting capacity. So it basically says that if you have a higher angle of wrap, that means you have more torque transmitting capacity, because you will have more frictional force to be for your use, basically, to transmit the power. Does it make sense to you guys?
Yes.
Okay, so there are some other configurations which says that how can you reverse the direction of the motion of the pulley. So if you have input going clockwise, you can have output going counterclockwise by having this type of configuration or this type of configuration. Here you have extra two pulleys in here, and this purpose of these extra two pulleys, basically they are called idlers. Idlers basically means they are just rotating at their idle location and they're not doing any transmission or transmitting power. They are just there to increase the tightening or to to increase the tension in the pull, in the belts, basically. If you want to increase the tension, you can change the distance of the idlers, and it will basically create more tension on the belt. And it is basically, we will see that it is the tension in the belt that is going to be helpful for transmitting the torque. So these are some more drives about how you are transmitting drives from the one shaft to another, which are perpendicular to each other. The plane of the shafts are perpendicular to each other. So this is basically an extreme example of transmitting a power from one pulley to another, which are out of plane, which is generally not possible with any other means. Basically, we have large center distances and the pulleys are out of plane. So these are basically cost effective way of transmitting the power. Is as you can see here, this is one of the ways of transmitting the power. And the right side figure is showing you the clutch system, a flat belt shifting without clutch. So without clutch, you can have the disengagement of the driven pulley. Basically, if you have a shifting fork, this is the driver. The belt is always remaining contact with the driver. You shift, use a shift fork, and the belt will slide over to the loose pulley. That means the power is disengaged from the rest of the powertrain. And when you would like to engage again, you can basically shift the belt again to the driven side, and you can have power back again. So basically, this is showing how can you use the belt drives using a loose pulley concept, which is basically a type of disengaging the power from the input to the output side and without any clutch in here. So this is one way of shifting the, or basically transmitting power without clutch or disengaging the power without clutch. So there are other potential and interesting uses of lead belt drives. So having said that, I think we have covered almost like the introductory part of the belt drive, and I think that this is the right time for me to stop at this point without going into the detailed calculations about how to find out the width of the belt, the length of the belt, how to decide that what should be the amount of material or what should be the amount of the cross section that should be useful for a given torque transmitting capacity. For a given torque rating, how should we select a belt drive when we know the center distances between the two shafts? How can we actually design? So we'll go through those calculations probably in the next lecture and try to wrap it up there. But today, I think this is the right point to stop, where we actually go through the discussion about the limit splits and tolerances, the stress transmitting capacity, the torque transmitting capacity, the stresses that are coming in the material, and some introductory concept about the belt drive. So having said that, let me wrap up, or let me stop at this point of time, and let me know if you have any questions or concerns.